Praise the Lord, everybody. Good afternoon to you. Good afternoon. I hope I'm not interrupting your dinner. If you're about to sit down and get real with those with those fried chicken and steaks. But I wanted to share this thought with you briefly, if you will mind. If you could do me the honor of sharing this and liking this and inviting your followers, that'd be fantastic. Great to see you, Sister Cheryl, Mr. Cedric, blessings to you, Mr. Michael. Good to see you, Brother Davis, Sister B, Tawanda, MJ, Dr. Prescott. Good to see everybody tonight. Jesus is alive, amen. He is alive. And speaking of dinner, I'm going to be eating soon, I think. So I'm going to just share this word, come in and come out. But I'll encourage you, please, to replay this, take a look at this, even take it seriously. Amen. Glory to God. Whereas I do come on live for my health, I really don't do this for my health. You know, this is far from a game for me. The word of the Lord is life. Amen. Bless his name. Glory to God. So come on in, everybody. I'm playing my theme song right now by Fred Hammond. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Good evening to you, Tawanda, Dr. Carlene. Blessings to you. My brother Curtis, good to see you. Come on in, folks. If you hit that share button, that like button, that'd be great. Glory to God. Bless his name. Overseer Donovan, good to see you, sir. Bless his name. Come on in, everybody. Glory to God. Glory to God. I believe that Jesus is alive. If you believe that Jesus is alive, I want you to type that in for me. Jesus is alive. Glory to God. If you believe that Jesus is alive, I want you to type that in for me right here and right now. Glory to God. Jesus is alive. Bless his name. Inna, good to see you today. Blessings to everybody. Thank you for coming on tonight. Glory to God. Jesus is alive. And as such, or as a living being who is at the right hand of the Father, the Bible says that he ever lives to make intercession for us according to the will of God. Right? So we don't have a dead God. We don't have a non-existent intercessor or mediator. When he rose from the dead, he ascended to the right hand of the Father. And there he is. At some point, he shall come to judge the living and the dead, the Bible says. But in the meantime and the in-between time, he is making intercession for us according to the will of God. So we give him things to intercede on our behalf with. Amen. And so I want you to lock that in. As you're coming in today, the price for admission is Jesus is alive. Come on, type that in for me. If you wouldn't mind, I appreciate that very much. Glory to God. Blessings to you, Kimberly, Christine, Elder Rufus. Blessings to everybody. Thanks for coming on tonight. Glory to God. It is my sincere hope, and I would even say my sincere prayer, that you are doing the natural things to strengthen yourself and to protect yourself, naturally speaking, during this interesting time that the entire world is experiencing, actually. I would encourage you not to get caught up into the hype or into the political matters involved here, but to do what's right and proper. There is a thing called wisdom, bless his name. There is a thing called wisdom. The Bible says that a wise man sees trouble coming, but a fool suffers for it. In other words, a fool stands there and takes the hit when you didn't have to be there for the hit, right? And so I want to encourage you to do that, to if you have to go out, that's a have to go out scenario. If you've got to go out and be in the public, that you take the necessary precautions. That makes sense? If somebody agrees with that, just type in amen. There's no fear in that. There's just wisdom in that. Glory to God. You lock your doors at night, don't you? Right? There's wisdom in that. Right? You wash your hands. You know, that's just good home training. But there's wisdom in that. Glory to God. You hear that there's a prowler in your neighborhood. You don't go outside and just say, hey, no big deal. It's not gonna hit me. You know, you take the precautions, right? And so we're in a phase or a season where we should be doing that. Secondly, and this is not in this exhortation that I'm going to share here in a moment, but secondly, we most certainly need to be asking this question personally. God, what are you saying to me in the midst of all of this? What are you saying to me in the midst of all of this? That does not put anything on God, that does not indict God in this situation. But we would be fools not to say, God, okay, I'm paused for the cause. What are you saying to me? What areas in my life do I need to bring in alignment, divine alignment? What areas in my mentality, even in my psychology, do I need to line up properly? That it won't hurt you at all to do that, right? So I hope that'll be something that you will consider during this phase. Amen. During this phase. Well, I want to direct your attention to a very familiar portion of scripture, but I believe it will help encourage us tonight. It's found in 1 Kings chapter 18. And we'll start in verse 41. The topic or the subject, or the more importantly, the title of this particular brief moment together is, it's time to take a knee. It's time to take a knee. Now that should, if you've been aware of events over the last couple of years, that should invoke something that says it's a protest. And I am. I'm going to announce that there ought to be a protest. So stay with me on that, right? Colin Kaepernick and others who took a knee. I want to remove it from the social justice, civil rights idea today and bring it to the fact that we need to take a knee in humility before God and begin to seek God as if our life depended upon it. Because quite frankly, I believe that our prayer can determine our life outcome. If you believe that prayer can determine a life outcome, would you type in, I agree? Just type in, I agree. Just type in, I agree. Blessings to everybody. Good to see you on today. Sister Sherrod, good morning. Good evening to you. Good to see you on as well. And I think I just saw one of the most famous people in all of America who just kind of popped in, I think. Her name is Miss Sarah Cheatham. If it's the same Sarah Cheatham, she was the woman that found me when I was in middle school. And I wasn't doing the right thing. And she pulled me out of a class and said, he can do better. And so, Miss Cheatham, I just want to salute you today and recognize you today. You were a great inspiration in my life when I didn't even know it. And you got me together. You got me together. So thank you for doing that. At Cleveland School in Englewood, New Jersey. Blessings to you, Mrs. Cheatham. All right. So it's time to take a knee. Are you hearing me? It's time to take a knee. And if you got any Jesus in you at all, this would be the time when you said, you know what, I'm gonna put all the issues aside. I'm gonna put church hurt aside. I'm gonna put unforgiveness aside. I'm gonna put what I think I know aside, you know, and I'm gonna get in between the rock and the hard place and seek the face of God. But there are some principles that I think that can come out of this text in 1 Kings chapter 18 that will speak to us. And so I pray that you're ready for that. 1 Kings chapter 18. Bless his name. I still believe that Jesus is alive. I still believe that Jesus is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, despite the difficult news that we heard today and the challenging hearing of various things. Jesus is alive. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 41, and the Bible reads like this. And Elijah said to Ahab, "Get up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of the abundance of rain." Now, the context of that is that they were facing a three-year drought. God forbid that we are in a sequestration, quarantine mandate for years. But they were in a three-year drought. And you have a king and you have a prophet. Elijah is the prophet. Ahab is the king. And the prophet says to the king, "I hear something." I want you to say right, I want you to get it in your spirit right now, that you best believe that there is an abundance on the horizon. Somebody type in amen. Somebody type in amen. There's an abundance on the horizon. Despite what it looks like, despite what you're feeling, despite what you're experiencing, there is an abundance on the horizon. Folks, this is where we got to grow up in the spirit. You hear me? This is the time when we got to get out of Chuck E. Cheese and get out of the merry-go-round and recognize that you've got to be able to hear something though you can't see anything. Are you hearing me? Right? You got to hear it before you're going to see it. Bless his name. I feel that one, Derek. Right? You have to hear something before you see something. And what I have discovered, even in this moment that I'm experiencing personally right now, I'm recognizing that as I yield myself to God, I start to hear stuff that contradicts what I'm seeing. Did you hear what I just said? I'm hearing things that contradict what I'm seeing. And I'm talking about in the positive. I'm hearing abundance when there's lack, right? I'm hearing health and healing when there's death and dying. I'm hearing miracles as opposed to being in despair and hopeless, right? But you and I've got to hear something before we're going to see something. But you got to get in a position for that. I want you to note in verse 41, excuse me, is that the prophet is the one hearing, not the king. Can I say it again? I said the prophet's hearing, not the king. So the word of the Lord is not coming from Washington. It's not coming from my state capital. It's not coming from my city capital. It's not coming from my governor, my mayor, or my president. It is coming from the Lord God. The three individuals are seats of authority. With all due respect to them, they do not have the word of the Lord. I'm going to follow the social distancing. I don't leave the house without my mask, and I do the things I need to do. But that's their realm. But there is another realm and a higher authority. Check this out though. That authority, the higher authority, is not contradicting the lower authority, but the higher authority is saying that there is something else coming that's going to be better than what you got going on right now. Are you hearing me? So the prophet is the one that actually spoke to the king. The king did not speak to the prophet. The prophet said, "This is how it's going to go down." The king was only trafficking in what he saw and what he knew. The prophet was clear on what was going on, but he also heard something else that was coming down the pike. Bless his name. Glory to God. "And you look much better in your future than you do right now. This that you are experiencing has come. But it has come to pass." Bless his name. That means it's going to pass. Come on, somebody type in. It's going to pass. This is going to pass. I am telling you that this is going to pass. But if you and I don't take a knee, We're not going to hear the sound of the abundance of rain. We're going to keep looking at dust and dirt and grime and brokenness and loss and misery and pain. I've got to be able to see through my tears and to see that there is a better day on its way. Glory to God. Did you hear that? I think that's a word. I think that's a rhema word, Denise. There's a better day. A better day. I'm writing it down myself. On the way. Glory to God. There's a better day on the way. We're in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 42. So Ahab did what the prophet said, went up to eat and drink. And Elijah went up to the top of Mount Carmel, and he cast himself down upon the earth. Pause for a moment there. This was the same place. This is important, folks. Mount Carmel was the same place where the prophet called down fire from heaven. In other words, I like to believe that the prophet went back to the last place of testimony and the last place he saw and heard God move. You can't, listen, you cannot base your future on what happened today. I got to base my future on the God that I know. Somebody type in, won't he do it? Just type it in. Won't he do it? Glory to God. You wouldn't be listening to me. You wouldn't be watching this right now. You wouldn't be on a phone or doing replay right now if you had not experienced the goodness of the Lord at some point in your life. At some point in your life, you knew it was the hand of God. Did I got anybody to testify to that right now? That you knew that you knew that you knew it was the hand of God. And it was only the hand of God. Despite other disappointments, despite other losses, despite other hurts, I know that I know that I know that there was a time when I saw the fire of God come into my life. I saw God walk through a wall in my life. I saw God pull me out of stuff. I saw God heal stuff. I saw God dry tears. I saw something. Bless his name, right? Elijah went back to the last place he called down fire. He saw God move. And he presided over the absolute destruction of 850 false prophets. I'm telling you by the word of the Lord that what God is going to do is going to shut the mouth of the lion. Going to shut the mouth of the naysayer, going to shut the mouth of the atheists, is going to shut the mouth of those who have walked away from even the Lord. I am telling you, you shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Glory to God. I just call myself going on live just to kind of just share a word of encouragement. And this thing is all over me right now. I am telling you, I hear the sound of abundance. And so Elijah went back to the place of testimony. I want to encourage you tonight. If you don't do anything else tonight, please testify to yourself of a day and a time when you know that you know God's hand came upon you. The five fingers of God came upon your life. It could have been in a demonstration of mercy that someone shared towards you, right? That you know you didn't deserve the break, but you got it anyway. Right? It could have been the time when you are out of your mind, but somehow God got your head together, right? You got to testify to that. Take yourself back to that. Stop looking at what just happened today and recognize that God is still good. Come on, somebody type in, God is still good. He is still good. In your tears, you need to be able to say that God is still good. Come on, somebody help me today. Write that in. God is still good. Glory to God. I wish I could sing and play an organ right now. I would do both at the same time, Regina. I would. I'd do both at the same time. Because God is still good. Broken heart, God is still good. Lost, God is still good. Diagnosis, God is still good. It doesn't matter what the government says. Right? And all the mass confusion going around, it's irrelevant because God is still good. The goodness of God did not change and does not change because of what CNN reports to us. The goodness of God does not change and will not change despite what's happened in your life on this very day or last week, this time last week. Are you hearing me? God is still good. Get that in your spirit today. Get it in your spirit. He's still good whether or not you can get a haircut, get your nails done, right? Or hang out with somebody, or he's still good. Bless his name. Glory to God. Glory to God. Let's take it a little bit further. We're in 1 Kings 18. So he went up to Mount Carmel. And the Bible says that he cast himself down upon the earth. And he put his face between his knees. I want you to hear that today and see that. I know you've read this before, so forgive me if it sounds to be repetitive, but the prophet took both knees. Some of us have yet to bend both knees. You got to catch that in your spirit today. You have yet to bend both knees and to go deep before the Lord. I mean this prophet assumed an ancient birthing position where he squatted and dropped his head between his knees. You could not see his face. He was as low as he could get without laying prostrate. Right? Now he's doing this in the midst of a famine, of a drought. Animals are dying. 3 years with no rain. This is going to be a problem, y'all. And the prophet went up to the last place of testimony and then threw himself on the ground and bent both knees. Come on, somebody type it in. It's time to take a knee. Time to take the knees, right? It's time to take the knees. Are you hearing me? That cannot even be, I mean, that could be literally, it is for me, but there are times, folks, when you could be walking but have a kneology in your spirit, right? Have a humility of your spirit where you're recognizing, God, I don't know all what's going on. I listen to that one, I listen to this one. But one thing I do know, that God, you're good. Bless his name. And Jesus, you're alive. And I call out to you. I recognize I can't do anything, quite honestly, except seek your face and then follow your instruction. It's time to take the knees. Are you hearing me? You got to get, I'm telling you, folks, got to get in your spirit. A demonstration of taking the knees is, like, for instance, if you kind of disappeared from the fellowship of the saints, if you're not connecting with your local assembly and you know, you spend all your time just watching TV and there's never any seeking of the face of the Lord and doing the things that God would have you do to help and bless other people, you've yet to take a knee. Because when you take both knees, you're going to hear something. Are you hearing me? Bless his name. I hope you're hearing this tonight. I really hope you're hearing this tonight. It's time to take a knee. It's time to take a knee. And so he assumed an ancient birthing position in which his head was between his knees. And then he gave an instruction, Mother Francine, he gave an instruction to his servant. He said, go up now and look toward the sea. May I insert this into this soliloquy? May I insert this? Elijah was the one who prophesied and said, it ain't going to rain until I say so. There are some things that are occurring in this season that are a direct result of your own prayers. I'm not talking about anybody dying. I'm not talking about anybody being sick. But I am saying that in this moment in time, whereas I believe the enemy will mean it for evil, God is going to turn this thing and it's going to show up to be an answer to your prayer. You're going to find yourself in a different place spiritually, which will impact every other area of your life. And so some things we go through is a result of our own prophecy. We just didn't know that to get from point A to point Z, we're going to have to go through a process. And I believe, this is me talking now, you judge it for yourself, but I believe that this season is a time of process whereby we are being processed, and you and I are learning what we really have and what we don't have, and who's down with us and who's not down with us, and how deep we are in the Lord and how much we believe God, you know. All of that stuff is working in this if you allow it to work. That makes sense? And so he told his servant, he said, listen, I want you to go over there, and I want you to look toward the sea and tell me what you see. What's interesting here, that there is no indication that Elijah told the unnamed servant what to look for. What to look for. May I offer this to you tonight? That which God is going to do, you can't even really look for it. Right? Because it's going to be something that's never been done before. Are you hearing me? Right? Get it in your spirit. The scripture says, it does not yet appear what we shall be. But when he appears, we're going to be like him. Right? So in this text, I want to borrow that. In this text here, the servant is told to go yonder and to tell me what you see. There's going to be a day in time when you're going to begin to see something that you never saw before. For some, you're going to see something that you haven't seen in a very long time. For some, you've given up even hope of having any semblance of normalcy and joy and peace and relief in your life. And it's going to be a new experience for you because no one ever told you that you would ever feel good again. Somebody is listening to me today, and you were told that you're never going to feel good again. They told you, they just flat out told you, man, that you're going to just kind of just deal with this thing because this is your lot in life. I am telling you by the word of the Lord, I am telling you that there is an abundance coming to your life. And I'm not just talking about cash, although that's going to be part of it. I believe that there is an abundance coming that you've not seen before. There's going to be a Rehoboth in your life, which means a wide open place that you've not seen before. There's going to be 12 wells that have been dug for you that you've never drank from before. There's going to be a breakthrough that heretofore you have never even thought about praying about. God is going to do that. Just check this out here. I'm just telling you. I'm just flat out telling you, right? So here the Elijah is in this ancient birthing position, set down. He looks up, he tells the servant, go over there and tell me what you see. Now what is implied here is that Elijah was praying. In a situation whereby there was no evidence of change. This is going to be the difference, folks, for many who break through and those who get broken. I'm here to tell you, it will be the ability to pray despite not seeing any evidence or encouragement to do so. So he tells him, and the guy comes back and announces these three words. There's nothing. Nothing. This is the maturing of Jeff. When I have to pray, although I don't see any change. I have to maintain my confession, although I don't see any change. I have to continue to press on despite the antagonistic thinking and thought process, my own process, let alone the process of others. This is where I got to grow up. I got to grow up. I think I push pretty hard. But there are times when it's easier just to believe what you see than to believe what you heard. Somebody should write that. Somebody should write that in your journal or something. There are times when it's easier to believe what you see than to believe what you've heard from God. I've got to go back to what God has said. Bless his name. I got to go back to what God has said. Got to go back to what God has said. What did God say? What did God say? What did God say? What did God say? Right? What is God saying? What is God saying? What is God saying? But you're not going to hear that unless you have the posture within your heart to bend both knees. Are you hearing me? Right? Yeah, this is a protest. This is a protest. It's not a social justice protest. It's not a protest against social distancing, but is it a protest against fear and doubt and unbelief and resignation? It's a protest. It's a protest against my own feelings. It's a protest against what I see. I'm going by what I hear from the Lord, not what I see with my natural eyes. I hope you'll do the same. And so when the servant came back from his little jaunt over the hill there, he came back and said, the prophet said to him, in response to there is nothing, the prophet said, go again 7 times. Someone type in 7X. Type in 7X for me. Would you mind? On Facebook and Periscope, just type in 7X. 7X. 7X, 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 7X. Now you and I know that God rested on the seventh day. Speaking of rest, speaking of conclusion, speaking of completion. I believe the scripture. So I believe he was told to go 7 times. Reverend Sherrod, the emphasis, though, I sense is that 7 being you go until you come back telling me something else. You go until. But he didn't say go sit in a lawn chair and show me something. He said go 7 times. That means he had to go. It had to be a little distance, y'all. So he had to go, come back, go and come back, go and come back, go and come back. This guy was probably saying, this is bananas. I don't even know what I'm looking for. And you got me running up and down the hill, running up and down the hill, running up and down the hill, coming back. I keep telling you the same thing. But you and I have got to make up our mind. Now we're going to go until we see what we heard. Do you hear that? I mean, I believe this, folks, and this may sound like a rebuke, but the body of Christ is weak when it comes to persevering in faith. We are weak. We are bona fide weak, and we're weak because we don't eat enough. We're weak because we're not before him enough. We're weak because we're not practicing what we're hearing. We're not applying what we're learning. That's why we're weak. And that's why after the second time, I give up. I just quit. I'm just not going to try it anymore, right? And we fall out and we go back to fishing and we go back to doing something dumb. But there are times when you got to keep going until. You got to keep going until you see what you heard. Amen? Come on. Come on, you gotta decide if there's going to be a quit in you. Are you hearing me? You have to decide. No one can do that for you. I can't do it for you. As a pastor, as a friend, as a brother, I can encourage you in the Lord, but you still have to decide if you're going to say, I'm not gonna quit. Come on, type that in. Say, I'm not gonna quit. Gonna, not going, gonna. G-O-N-N-A. Right? I'm not going to quit. And what I mean by that is that you're going to keep going till you see what you heard. Elijah went to his knees and said, I'm going to birth this thing. I'm going to bring this thing to pass. I am not going to quit because I'm going to birth it because I heard something. Bless his name. I heard something. I heard that God is good. I heard that he is a deliverer. I heard that he is a way maker. I heard that. I heard that he is a miracle worker. I heard that he is a comforter. I heard that he is a sustainer. And I'm going to stay in the cut until I see what I heard. Bless his name. I'm going to stay in that spot until I see what I heard. And there may be some difficult times, maybe on trip number 5 and trip number 4 and trip number 7. I might get some bad news on that, but I'm still not going to quit. Bless his name. I am not going to quit. Why? Because I can trust the one in whom I believe. Can you trust him? Do you know him? Do you know him to be a liar? You do not know him. If he's a liar to you, you don't know him. Glory to God. He cannot lie. Hallelujah. So he goes 7 times and he comes back. And the Bible says in verse 44, 1 Kings 18, verse 44, and it came to pass at the 7th time. Come on, you got to type it again. You got to type it for me again. You got to type in 7X again. You got to type in 7X again. You got to type in 7X again. You got to type in 7X. You got to type in 7X. One more time, 7X. 7X. Oh, this is the 7th time, y'all. This is a completion. There's a rest day. There's a moment when it's done, over, complete, in the bag, finished, handled. There is that day coming. But you got to get to the 7th day. Bless his name. You got to get to the 7th day. Every time the servant would come back and say, there's nothing. He told that man there was nothing 6 times. That could be discouraging. I was a bit discouraged today. That could be discouraging when you hear something over and over again, right? That's contradictory to what you've already heard from the Lord, right? That could be discouraging. And he heard that. He had this. Listen to me. You got to remain in that position, because if you get in that position, when the negativity comes or the honest appraisal, the man wasn't lying to him. There was nothing. So he wasn't being down. He was just saying, ain't nothing happening, right? But if you get in that position, when that comes at you, it doesn't penetrate deep into your soul. Why? Because you are in such a position here that you're able to have that thing bounce, right? You can fight that thing off. You can fight that thing off because you know, what I write down, a better day is coming my way. Glory to God. A better day is coming my way. A better day is coming my way. Glory to God. I'm here to tell you, a better day is coming my way. A better day is coming my way. That ought to get in your spirit today. Someone should take that home. You ought to take that home. A better day is coming my way. And so he heard it 7 times. But the Bible says in verse 44, and it came to pass at the 7th time. At the 7th time. Glory to God. I feel like running around this room right now, Renee. I'm telling you before God, I tell you, I just want to start running around my office, bouncing off the wall right now. At the 7th time. See, some of you thought you were at the 7th time. You're not at the, let me tell you, when you know you're at the 7th time, the 7th time is when it's done. You might have had some long 5 times. You know what I mean? Some 6 days that were really long. But I'm here to tell you, listen, if you don't give up, you win. Glory to his holy name. Glory to his holy name. So the 7th time, the Bible says, he said to the prophet, he said, behold, there ariseth a little cloud out of the sea, like the size of a man's hand. The prophet nor the servant would have seen the beginning of their miracle had they not gone seven times. I am absolutely convinced, that there have been things that did not occur simply because I didn't stay in the ancient birthing position long enough. And I didn't wait till my seventh time. In the midst of this thing that we don't know what it is, thing that's happening all around us, you need to stay in the cut. You need to keep your head between your knees. You need to keep saying, I'm not going to quit until I see what I heard. I'm not going to quit until I see what I heard. And your miracle, help me, Jesus, your miracle is usually disguised in the size of a seed. Your miracle is usually something that has a beginning, and then there's this great manifestation of it. And there are times when we are making progress, but because it's not what we want and what we need in totality, we despise it and we give up. It's like somebody having a $100 need and someone hands them a $20 bill and they're saying, I can't pay anything with this. I can't. What am I going to do with this? Somebody who's watching right now, if you can just get some progress in your health, if you can get from one day to the next without having to take as much medication, don't take yourself off medication. I'm talking about as your symptoms are changing and there's evidence that there's progress, a little progress. Don't despise that. See it as a little cloud rising out of the sea. Are you hearing me? It's time to take a knee, y'all. It's time to take a knee. It's time to get in the cut. It's time to grow up. And when I mean that, because some of you say, Pastor, I pray all the time. I pray all. Okay, I hear you. then we're not talking with you right now. But I am talking to me, and I am talking to others. It's time to take it up. Time to take it up to a I'm not gonna quit level, right? Time to take it up to a I'm not gonna quit level. And when you do that, you're gonna find yourself greatly encouraged despite what you're hearing from something or somebody else. Are you hearing me tonight? Hallelujah. You know what I wanna do? Now I know that there's some of my brother pastors and ministers on the line who do this differently, but you know what I want to do? I want you to sow a seed tonight in the form of a seven, if you can. 7 cents, $7, $70, $100, $17, $27, $37, $107, something. But I'm not going to sit here and tell you that the Lord told me that somebody needs to sow a seed in denominations of seven. You know what I mean? I'm not going to tell you that, you know. But I think that'd be a good thing to do. I think it'd be a good thing to do to sow into the word that you just heard according to Galatians chapter 6 and in a form of a seven if you can. If you don't want to, you can do a different number or you can don't do anything at all. You know what I mean? But if you don't do anything else, what I want you to do, though, is I want you to take the posture, ancient birthing posture, and birth a miracle for the rest of us. My Cash App is Jeff Williams, and if you understand kingdom prosperity and how it works and sowing and reaping, you will not be offended by me putting that out there. You always have the option not to. Doesn't change my love for you anything at all. But I just know that there's power in sowing and reaping. And so I want to offer that to you today. And you put that out there. Let's see if I did it right. I think I did. Okay. All right. All right, folks. So listen, we're going to go. But I wanted just to share that with you today. Lord willing, tomorrow morning, as the Lord speaks to me and encourages my heart, I want to do the same for you. So I'll come back at some point in some time. And but get in position. Would you do me a favor? And whenever you type in this affirmation. I am in position. Type it in. I am in position. Thank you, Mrs. Lee John. Thank you for that. Appreciate that encouragement. Blessings to you as well. I am in position. Just type it in. I am in position. You want to be in an ancient birthing position. Glory to his name. I am in position. Tawana's done it. I see at DWATTURIT typed it in. Deacon Cheryl's typed it in. Renee's typed it in. Compassion Carter's typed it in. Suzette's in position. Glory to his name. In position. Cleo, blessings to you. She's in position. Gwen's in position. Sandra's in position. Wesley's in position. Donna's in position. Yeah. Again, I just offer that to you. You can sell any denomination or not at all, but I would offer that to you to do that. All I know is as I sow, I grow. And when I sow into a word, it enables me to hold the word that I sow. So you should check that out in Galatians chapter 6. I think it's a powerful thing. Blessings to his name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Mother Cheatham, I don't know. Hopefully you can share the broadcast. Hope you can. And again, for those who just come on, Miss Sarah Cheatham was the boss in our middle school. And she found me in a class. And she may not even remember this, but found me in a class where students who were not behaving well were placed. And students who were falling behind were placed. And, you know, I was fighting and carrying on and just acting up. And she appeared at the door one day. And she said, give him to me. He can do better. That was the end of that. And so Mrs. Treatham, 3 degrees later, I kept fighting for a little while longer, but I got better. Bless his name. So blessings to you. So glad to see you on today. All right, folks, listen, have a wonderful day. Let me pray for everybody. Father, I ask a great blessing to come upon those that are watching, listening tonight. I believe that you are still hearing the prayers of those who are righteous in Christ. And I'm going to boast of that today, that my righteousness is in Christ Jesus and not in my own. But with that said, Father, we need your grace. We need a smearing on of your grace, a smearing on of strength, and a smearing on of comfort, and a smearing on of help. Bless his name. A smearing on of that today. An ability to open our hearts more to you, God. Father, speak to us in this season. Cause our ears to open to hear the abundance of rain. Glory to God, for a better day is coming their way. I speak blessing over them as your son and as a servant today. I speak blessing in the matchless name of Jesus. I speak blessing to nerve damage. Here it is, nerve damage. Somebody's got nerve damage, and they've told you that that those nerves will never be right. They'll never come back, and I am telling you, they shall come back. some people's nerves are getting on their nerves. And so I curse that radiating pain and that consistent pain. I bind that now in the name of the Lord Jesus. Command it to come out of your body. Loose you now. Loose you now. In the name of Jesus, who's the head of the church. I command that thing to release from your body this very second. Bless his name. Thank you, Lord. All right, folks. Love you all. Thanks for being on today. And thank you for, if you decided to sow, I don't know who did, but thank you for your encouragement. Thank you for your sowing. But more importantly, thank you for staying in position. Love you all. Have a great day. Bye now. Hey, mom and dad. Blessings to you. Thank you. Appreciate your encouragement. Thank you, everybody, for your encouragement. Blessings to you. Blessings to you. Thank you.